And I kind of just looked up Salvatore Magluta, and on internet you actually have an inmate registry. You could search for American inmates, and what comes up? Salvatore Magluta, age 65, release date, year 2166 or 2166. He's released, and he's right now at United States Penitentiary, Florence, like supermax penitentiary.
They transfer him to another one. They caught him with a cell phone and they send his ass back there.
Wow. And, you know, and do you feel bad for introducing them to the business? Because, I mean, you're free now, but they're locked up. Or do they have themselves to blame as well?
Here's the background. I love Sal still because he's my, you know, we grew up as little kids.
Yeah.
But they didn't do me right. I handed the cartel. When I realized I wasn't going to come out to prison, I handed the cartel to him.
Yeah.
In exchange for them, I gave him 30, the equivalent to buy me 30 kilos, I forgot what it was, every load, sell it, and save me the profits to whenever I got out of prison, right?
Yeah.
And by God's grace, when I got out of prison, they said they had left the drug business. Because if you keep reading, there's a case, in his case, when he goes to trial, okay, I'm a witness for him, and I'm a witness for the government.
I think I read that. Yeah.
Let me know what happened. So, yeah, I mean, I had to give his attorney permission to defend him because he was my attorney, Marty Weinberg.
Yeah.
So what happened?
The best in the U.S. or Canada.
Oh, I mean, yeah, back in 79 for my case, guy charged me $100,000 just to tell me whether he would take the case or not.
Oh,
most brilliant attorney in the world.
Yeah.
But what ended up happening is when I got arrested the second time, all it was they wanted my money.
Yeah.
The government wanted my money.
Yeah, the second time, exactly. Yeah,
I had walked away for 4 years. You know, when I came out of prison, I went back to the same thing, but then I realized the world had changed.
Yeah.
You know, there was a lot of violence. Pablo Escobar had come into the scene. Yeah. That's not the people that I was dealing with way back. And I went back for 2 years, and in 87, I said I had enough.
Exactly.
I can't do this. And I walked away. I walked away from making $1 million a month doing nothing. I mean, literally nothing. You know, all I would say is send a plane, don't send a plane. I started my own routes again, you know, and went back with Manuel Garces. And so in reality, they ended up doing me wrong, but they did me a favor in the long run. Because what happens when I make my deal with the government, all they wanted was everything I had, over $40, $50 million worth of assets. And I pled guilty. I got sentenced because since they never caught me with anything, both times I went to prison, there's never been a wiretap of me, ever.
Ah.
There's never been a compromising picture of me, ever.
Yeah.
The only reason I got arrested was because my attorney, who I love, who was my closest friend, ratted me out.
Oh, really? He did?
That's the only reason, because the government never knew about me.
Oh, so did the attorney?
Mel Kessler, my first attorney in the 70s, he got caught. And when he got caught, he started cooperating with the government and telling, hey, I'm going to give you someone bigger than me that nobody knows.
I missed that.
They never caught me.
Wow.
That's why when they brought me to the United States in 79, they gave me $7 million bail. And I'm like, holy cow, I'm 23. I don't have a traffic ticket.
Yeah,
I worked for the government all my life. I'm arrested in a different company with nothing. You give me $7 million like if I was a Hannibal.
And that was the highest bail in the U.S. at that time or something.
Ever in the history. Ever.
Wow.
As a matter of fact, the bail laws were changed. Yeah, they $7 million, they lowered it to $2 million because they were teasing me to pay the $2 million, which was I was about to pay.
To see if you have the money.
And to take it. And to take the money and then raise the bail. But we had attorneys that had information inside the government, so we knew what was going on. So I just imposted it.
At what time did your old attorney rat you out? Was that in the 70s or in the 80s?
No, in the 70s. This is. I got arrested in April 79.
But so he ratted you out already then. So the government had their eyes on you since late 70s.
Literally 3 months before I got arrested.
Wow.
Is when he started cooperating. I didn't even find out till years later. I got on the freedom of information.
We have the same in Sweden where you could take out the info about you.
Right.
Is that really legal what that lawyer did? I mean, as a lawyer, you're supposed to be keep your secrets, right?
Yeah, but you know what? In America, that doesn't exist anymore.
Ah, okay, okay. So, and I have a nice quote here. I read through your free book, your free ebook that I signed up for on your site. The judge that you met at your second sentencing said like this: "Mr. Valdes, before you say anything, I want you to know that I rejected any agreement that you have made with the government, now or in the future, and I also that I intend to sentence you to a life sentence. Young man, you're going to die in federal prison." That was what the judge said, but you managed to get out of that, which is...
Well, what happened when I get arrested, and I had no clue. I'm clean. I've been clean for 4 years. I had no idea. The group that I dealt with that was bringing the drugs for me, 85, 86, 87, when I walked away, they kept going.
Yeah.
So literally, legally, only in America though, they can charge me with what was called the continued criminal enterprise, right? In other words, if you join my organization and all you ever do in your life is deliver a briefcase with $10,000 and I get life, you can get life.
Wow.
But the law is whoever gets the highest sentence, everybody gets the same sentence.
Ah, yeah. And also time could pass. It could pass 10 years after you got those.
Exactly. Statute of limitation ends when the organization ends. That's when the
5 years. And the organization is still ongoing, even though you left it.
But the witness against me there was a pilot that was the guy bringing our drugs in. But the night they take me to Mobile, Alabama, which I've never been in my life, the night they take me there, he killed himself while he was a government witness. He was still smuggling using a DEA airplane.
Wow, yeah, he crashed. That's right. Now I remember. So you were kind of lucky. That's why they couldn't really lock you up for sure.
Well, yeah, so my attorney said, hey, you're going to walk. But you know what? I had a religious conversion. And honestly, I wanted to put that life behind. Like I tell people, look, we're not defined by our past. But there's consequences to the choices we make in our past. Yeah. It has to be. Otherwise, life is just not fair.
Yeah.
Well, so when I got arrested, my attorney's argument was, listen, he walked away 4 years ago. So it's not that he's sorry about what he's doing because now you caught him. He was sorry back then when he walked away from making millions.
Yeah.
Number two, he's willing to voluntarily give you all his assets, which you cannot take.
Yeah.
Even in the continued criminal enterprise. Because there were assets that they tried to take in 79. And see, they didn't take them in 79. They can't take them again in 90.
Ah, okay. That's right. That's right.
So he's willing to give you all that. You should sentence him to the 10 years that he has on parole because he's going to confess that he violated his parole.
Yeah.
So, and time went. And then the judge finally, when he sentenced him, he said, look, I have a hard time with the sentence, but I believe the person I'm sentencing is not the person that committed those crimes.
Exactly.
And he gave me the 10 years.
Yeah, because when you read that last sentence, young man, you're going to die in federal prison. That was said before your witness died or?
Oh, no, yeah. Oh, that was, no, the witness had already died.
Okay.
So the witness, the minute I arrived in the courthouse.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah, this is after I went to the government and I signed over all my assets.
Yeah. Wow! Yeah, and
in front of the judge to plead.
So basically, you could thank God basically for.
To me, I do. Yeah. To me, I thank God because I believe that I had given my life over to God. I was an atheist all my life. You know, hardcore atheist. Yeah. I didn't believe in church, God, or anything like that.
Yeah.
But the guy that when I walked away from the cartel and hired this guy to teach me karate, for 3 years. He kept talking to me about God. And the thing that people ask me, what he said that made you change? I said, well, really nothing. Cause he was for 2 hours whooping my ass that I was just getting over that.
Yeah.
But what it was I began to see his lifestyle. Yeah. This guy had an old beat up car. He lived in a little, 120 square meter house. My house was over 1500 square meter. My guest house was three times his house.
Crazy.
And he married to the same woman for 25 years. And I'm like, holy cow, you're in love with a woman that's grabbing her 40? You're out of your mind. I'm going out with the most beautiful supermodels and I can't stand any of them.
Yeah.
How can you be happy?
Yeah.
And so I remember it was July 1st, 1990, and my divorce was final and my wife was dragging away my little girl and she was crying for her daddy. And I went to my room and I said, God, number one, I don't believe that you're real. That's, I want to be transparent. You know, I don't bullshit or anything like that. I said, no, two, if you are, you're looking at me and saying, you're so bad, I don't want you up here. but if you are the reason that man has got all that joy and he's got nothing to be happy about,
yeah,
I don't want that. Or kill me, because I was miserable. I had all these women, all this power, all this money, jets, you know. I mean, my whole life at the end there when I got caught was, you know, I spent the winters in my house in Vail skiing. Then I go to the horse shows in the spring. Then in the summer, I spend it in my house on the ocean. And then in the meantime, I was back and forth to my ranch. So, you know, I around my own jet.
And when you found God there with your karate trainer, was that like, was it like 1 year before you got arrested or something like that?
It was actually, I did that July 1st and I got arrested November.
Oh.
September of the same year.
But it was a couple of months there that God helped you away from that federal prison to die there.
Well, and I think what it was, yeah, without a doubt, I think that, that's, you know, I tell people, I believe that God intervened in my life. He saw, number one, that I was sorry for what I had done.
Yeah,
that
genuinely sorry.
Walked away, but I still had to pay for the crime I did. I mean, because I still went back to jail for another 5 years.
Yeah.
And if you think going to jail 5 years is bad, it's really bad when you go back again 5 years.
Yes, but it's not as bad as sitting on a supermax prison to year 2162.
Well,